but it became very popular in the last years. So I'm going to speak about binomial AJDLs. Yesterday I made a search in archive to see how many papers on binomial AJDLs have been produced in the last years, and I was surprised searching binomial AJDLs in the abstract field in archive gave me a list of 78 papers. So it's quite a lot of work. Of course, I will not be able to refer to all of them. Actually, I didn't read all of them, but I will survey some of them that I know, let's say, better, and they provide some nice results in this topic. I know, on the other hand, that there are several very strong groups who work on the binomial AJDLs. I know, for example, also in India, there is a strong group who work on the regularity of binomial AJDLs, on the Ries algebras, on the powers of binomial AJDLs. There is also a strong group with very nice results on the homological properties of binomial AJDLs in Iran, also in Italy, and some of those papers I'll mention in my talk today. Also in Japan, there are quite a few people who work on this topic. So in the first two parts of my talk, I will survey known facts about Grobner basis primary decomposition and the homological properties of binomial AJDLs. And in the last part of the talk, I will speak about powers of binomial AJDLs, especially with quadratic Grobner basis, which was the subject of a recent paper of Giancarlo Rinaldo, Naoki Terai, and myself, which you may find actually in archive. Anyway, the main point in studying binomial AJDLs is to relate the algebraic or homological properties of these ideals to the combinatorial features of the graph. This will be obvious during my talk. So let us introduce binomial AJDLs. So we consider a graph on the vertex set N. By graph, I mean always a simple graph, so undirected, without loops, multiple edges. And we consider the generic matrix, 2 by N matrix, with x1, xn on the first row, y1, yn on the second row. And in this matrix, we collect all the maximal minors, so minors of order 2, which correspond or are determined by the edges of G. So we look at the edges ij of G, and we consider the corresponding minor defined by the ith column and the jth column. We collect all these two minors corresponding to the edges of G, and this is the binomial ideal of G, which of course is an ideal in the polynomial ring in the variables x1, xn, y1, yn over some field k. So the most common examples one could consider are the binomial AJDLs associated with the complete graph on n vertices. So in this case, in fact, we have to collect all the two minors of the matrix X. So the binomial AJDL of the complete graph is actually the determinantal ideal generated by all the two minors of the matrix X. And the second, let's say, common or easiest example is the binomial AJDL which corresponds to the path graph, is if we label its vertices in a natural way, then we have the edges 1, 2, 2, 3, up to n minus 1, n. And then the binomial JDL associated to the path graph is generated by all the so-called adjacent minors of the matrix X. As probably most of you know, these binomial JDLs have been independently introduced in two papers 10 years ago. The first one by Herzog, Hibi, Hreizdottir, Kalle, and Rauch, and the other one is due to Ohtani. And since then, it was a lot of work on these binomial JDLs, and even there is a chapter in the relatively recent monograph of Herzog, Hibi, and Osugi, which has a very consistent chapter on binomial JDLs, where you may find part of what I'm going to present today. I will start with Grobner basis. The Grobner basis of binomial JDLs were studied in the first paper that I mentioned. They are very much connected, so to say, to the combinatorics of the graph. In order to explain how to get the Grobner basis of a binomial JDL, we have to introduce the notion of admissible path. So we take a path with ends I and j, let's say I smaller than j, and this is called admissible if all the indices from I1 to IR minus 1 actually from I0 to IR, they are pairwise distinct. Probably the most important condition is that for any index from I1 to IR minus 1, we should have either, so these indices should be either smaller than the smallest end or larger than the largest end of the path. And the last condition is a kind of minimality condition for the path. So we shouldn't have another shorter path with the same property. For example, if we look at this graph in this picture, we have this admissible path 3, 2, 5. This is because the vertex 2 has a label which is smaller than the 3, which is the smallest among 3 and 5. So this is 3, 2, 5 is an example of admissible path. And this happens because this edge 3, 5 is missing in our graph. And now to each admissible path, one associates a monomial in the polynomial ring, where we collect, in this product, we collect all the variables xik with the property that ik is greater than the largest end of the path, and the variables YIL, where IL is smaller than the smallest end of the path. For example, if we look at our admissible path in this picture, 3, 2, 5, the corresponding monomial is Y2 because 2 is smaller than 3. And of course, every edge is also an admissible path, and the corresponding monomial is just the constant monomial 1. And the theorem, which gives the Grobner basis, says that the reduced Grobner basis of JG with respect to the lexicographical order induced by the natural order of the indeterminates consists of all the binomials U, pi, F, I, J, where pi is an admissible path from I to J. For example, if we look at our graph with this labeling, you can easily see that the only admissible path which is not an edge is this one, 3, 2, 5. So in the reduced Grobner basis, we have to collect all the binomials which correspond to the edges of the graph together with the binomial which is associated with this 3, 2, 5 admissible path. So we have this reduced Grobner basis. So all the binomials which correspond to the edges, these are on the first two rows. And the last binomial is Y2, F3, 5. So this is the Grobner basis with respect to the lexicographic order. As we have seen in this theorem, So in the Kroemner basis, we have only binomials with square-free initial monomials. So this means in particular that the initial ideal with respect to the lexicographic order is a radical ideal, and this implies that the ideal itself is radical. So GG can be written as the intersection of its minimal prime ideals. And now, in order to characterize, to find these minimal prime ideals, which have been also studied in the in the first paper that I have mentioned, we have to introduce some notation. So if we take a subset of N, which may be also empty, and we consider the connected components of the restriction of G to the complement of this set S. So when we remove the elements, the vertices from the set S, we are left with some other graph which may have some connected components, and we denote these connected components G1, G2 up to GC of S. And now we consider the for each connected component, we consider the complete graph on the vertex set of that component. And we do the following fact. So we collect all the variables which correspond to the vertices in S, and then we add all the binomial edge ideals which correspond to the complete graphs GI tilde. And when we sum up all these ideals generated by these variables XI, YI with IS and all these binomial edge ideals, we get a prime ideal which obviously contains the ideal JG for any set. And it was proved that JG is actually the intersection of these prime ideals. So if we are looking for the minimal primes of JG, then we should search in this list of prime ideals. And this was done in the same paper. So the minimal primes among PS of G are those which have either S empty set, the empty set, or maybe, or if S is not empty, then it should have the following property. For each vertex I, which is in S, the number of connected components, which are determined by S, should be larger than the number of connected components, which are determined by S minus I. So if we remove the vertex I from S, we should have a smaller number of connected components. And a set S which satisfies this condition was called a cut point set, or simply a cut set. This is somehow the naming is due to the fact that if S contains just one vertex, then S is a cut point set if and only if I is a cut point of G. So this means that if I remove I from the vertex set of G, what the remaining graph has more connected components than the original graph. So once, for example, we can easily see that the empty set is the only cut point set if and only if each connected component of G is a complete graph. And I give here another example, which is very easy, but illustrates how we construct the minimal primes. We find the minimal primes of a binomial edge ideal. So I take a connected graph. This is a path on five vertices, and it clearly all the each of the vertices 2, 3, and 4 is a cut vertex of the graph. Because, for example, if we remove 2, then we get two connected components. One is the isolated vertex 1, and the other one is the path 3, 4, 5. So the number of connected components when I remove the vertex 2 is 2, while the original graph had one connected component. So this is indeed a cut point set. And also we have the cut point set formed only with the vertex 3 or with the vertex 4, or we can choose we can have the cut set form with the vertices 2 and 4, because if we remove 2 and 4 from this graph, then we are left with three connected components, actually three trivial connected components, which consist each of them from just one vertex. And now, for example, if we removed, if we choose s equal to 2, so we remove this vertex and we have the two connected components, what we should put in the minimal prime. So we put the variables x2, y2, and also the binomial HIDL, which is associated with the complete graph on the vertices 3, 4, and 5. And these are the generators of P2 of G. And in the similar way, we can construct P3 of G, for example, or P4 of G. And for P2, 4 of G, if we remove 2 and 4, then we are left with three trivial connected components. So we don't have binomials among the minimal generators of the minimal prime. This is just a monomial ideal generated by x2, y2, x4, y4, 2, 4 being the vertices in the cut set S. So in this way, we construct the minimal primes of binomial HIDL. So since JG is radical, so we may write JG as the intersection of its minimal primes. And the minimal primes, as we have seen, correspond to the cut point sets of the graph G. And we denote by M of G this cut point set of cut point sets of G. And we have seen how this PS of G is defined. So since all these ideals which appear as terms in this sum are in this joint set of variables, we can easily compute the height of each such ideal PS of G, in particular the height of each minimal prime of JG. So this means that we can compute the dimension of S mod JG. And this dimension is maximum of this number n plus the number of components determined by S minus the cardinality of S. And because always we have among the cut point sets the empty set for which this number becomes n plus the number of connected components of G. So this means that dimension, first of all, is greater than or equal to n plus the number of components of G. But in particular, since this empty set is among the cut point sets, we derive that if the binomial ideal is unmixed, which is the case, for instance, if JG is Cohen-Macaulay, then all the minimal primes should have the dimension equal to n plus the number of connected components. So in particular, if G is connected, then it is unmixed. JG is unmixed if and only if for every minimal prime, we have this equality. So this means the number of connected components determined by S should be the cardinality of S plus 1. So this is a very easy observation, but in many, many arguments, it's very useful. Now, in the second part of the talk, I will refer to resolutions of minimal free resolutions of binomial HIDLs. So, in general, for a graded ideal in a polynomial ring, we know that we have a finite minimal graded free resolution, where all the modules in the resolution are free S modules, actually copies. A direct sum of copies of shifted copies of S, and this number shows how many times we take such a copy S minus J in Fi, and these exponents are called the Grady-Betti numbers of S of over I. Usually, when we study resolutions of graded ideals, we start with thinking of the projective dimension which is defined as the maximum of the homological degrees where we find some non-zero Betti numbers, or equivalently, we study the depths of the gradient ideal, or we think about the regularity, which is defined as the maximum of these differences j minus I whenever beta ij is non-zero. Actually, the gradient Betti numbers usually are displayed in what we used to call the Betti diagram of S mod I. So in this diagram, in the intersection of the column I with the row j, we put the gradient Betti number beta I plus j. So in this Betti diagram, which has this shape, we can read also the projective dimension and the regularity in, according to our definitions. And the fat dots in this picture are the extremal Betti numbers. There are many nice and interesting results about the regularity of binomial edge ideals. And among these results, the one of the most interesting and I think the first result, important result on the regularity of binomial edge ideals was given by Matsuda and Murai. So for a connected graph, here I should have a mention. So if we have a disconnected graph and we want to study the depths or the regularity for binomial edge ideal, associated binomial edge ideal, we may do it only for the connected case, because since when we have several connected components and we consider the quotient ring by the binomial edge ideal, then this splits into a tensor product, because to each component, in each component we have different, not different. So the sets of variables involved in each component, these sets are pairwise disjoint. So we can make the tensor product, and then if we know the regularity for each component, then we know the regularity for the whole graph, and the same is true for depths. So very often I will simply consider the case of connected graphs when discussing regularity or projective dimension. So let us go back and mention the result of Matsuda and Murai, who gave lower and upper bounds for the regularity of a binomial edge ideal. So the upper bound is given by the number of vertices of the graph minus one, and the lower bound by the longest induced path of G. For example, from this lower bound, we can derive immediately that the binomial edge ideal has a linear resolution. So this is equivalent to saying that its regularity is equal to two if and only if the graph is complete. And Matsuda and Murai conjectured in their paper from 2013 that the regularity is maximum, is equal to n minus 1, if and only if the graph is a path graph. And this was proved by Sara and Chiani a few years ago. So they showed that the regularity is indeed n minus 1 if and only if G is a path graph. Following their the arguments in their proof, in a recent paper with Giancarlo Rinaldo and Naoki Terai, we gave a little bit, let's say, better upper bound for the regularity, namely the n minus the dimension of the clique complex of G. So the simplicial complex, which is called clique complex of G, consists actually, I mean, it has the faces, the complete subgraphs of the graph. So our bound is n minus the dimension of this clique complex. Another nice bound which was proved for any graph in a very recent paper paper by Malaeri, Sara and Chiani, is the number of maximal clicks of G. So maximal clicks are the complete subgraphs of G of maximal cardinality. I should also here mention that this conjecture was done by Sara and Chiani a few years ago. They succeeded first to prove it for chordal graphs, and I think that Arvind Kumar also has another proof for this inequality for chordal graphs. But now we have a proof due to this paper for any graph. There were also some, it was also some work on the binomial edge ideas of small regularities. So the smallest regularity for JG is 2. This is the case when the binomial edge idea has a linear resolution because it is generated in degree 2. So the next step would be to study regularity 3, and this was done by Sara and Chiani in this paper. So they showed that the regularity is 3 if and only if either G consists of a disjoint union of 2 complete graphs, or is the joint graph of 2 other graphs of smaller regularity. Now, going to the projective dimension or to the depths, I'd like to mention this result, which gives an upper bound for the depths, which is equivalent, of course, to a lower bound for the projective dimension. This upper bound depends on the so-called vertex connectivity of G of the graph, which is denoted here by L. And this L is the maximum integer such that the graph is L vertex connected. And L vertex connected means that if we remove from the graph a smaller number than L of vertices, then what is left, it is connected. I should mention that actually this is inequality for depths is indeed sharp, because we know already some examples where we have equality. For example, we proved in probably the first paper which studied this kind of questions like depths or Coyle-Macaulay in 2011, that if we have a tree with at least 3 vertices, the depth is the number of vertices plus 1. So because the tree has vertex connectivity 1, so we get this equality, and we also can get equality for the cycles because they are 2 vertex connected, and this is clear, and it was proved by Zafar and Zahid in a paper in 2013 that the projective dimension is equal to n, so we have equality. But of course, I mean, there are also one may construct or give examples of graphs for which we have strict inequality here. Now, as for the other bound, for the lower bound, I mentioned this very recent paper, which is posted online in Journal of Algebra, which gives a lower bound for the general lower bound for the depths of binomial edge ideal. So this bound says, for example, if our graph is connected and is not a complete graph, then the depth is at least 4. And the authors obtained this lower bound by using another very interesting paper, which gives a Hochster-type formula for the local cohomology modules of binomial edge ideals. So as I said, in the case when G is connected and non-complete, then we get here the lower bound equal to 4. And in the same paper, the authors characterized the graphs for which we get these minimal depths. So they consist, they are actually joint graphs of some arbitrary graph G prime joined to with a graph with which consists of two isolated vertices. And yesterday on archive, I have seen a new paper of these authors, which discusses a lower bound for the depths of binomial edge ideals, but combinatorially, so which is related to the combinatorics of the graph. And also they characterize the graphs for which the depths is equal to 5. There are also many other works which studied depths or even Betti numbers of binomial edge ideals. I would mention among them the paper of Herzog and Rinaldo on the extremal Betti numbers of binomial edge ideals of block graphs, where they actually introduced the notion of decomposability of graphs, which is very useful in studying binomial edge ideals. I would also mention the paper of Kumar and Sarkar, where from Mathematische Nachrichten, where among other things, they give a nice construction of graphs, connected graphs, which can reach a given regularity and any number of extremal Betti numbers between 1 and that regularity. And also a very recent paper, Binomial Edge Ideals of Co-graphs, which studies regularity bounds in terms of other graph invariants. I found this also very interesting, like the independence number or the number of maximal independent sets. So there are still many directions in, or many other questions to be approached in this study of regularity and depths for binomial edge ideals. Now, if we know something about depths and about the dimension of binomial edge ideals, the natural question is whether we can characterize Cohen-Macaulay binomial edge ideals. And until a few days ago, I would have said that it's somehow in any case, it's a very difficult problem to approach in the most generality, this Cohen-Macaulay property. But in the meantime, I have seen this week in archive a paper which I am going to mention later, which made a very good progress in approaching this Cohen-Macaulay property. But I'd like to mention also our paper, which I already mentioned earlier, from 2011, together with Professor Herzog and Hibi, where we studied two classes actually of graphs from this point of view of the Cohen-Macaulay property of the associated binomial edge ideal. And in the first place, we showed that for what we call now block graph, this means a chordal graph with the property that any two distinct maximal cliques intersect in at most one vertex, then the depth of S mod GG is n plus the number of connected components of G. And we also showed that the Quayle-Macaulay property is equivalent to the unmixedness of JG, and we also characterize in terms of the combinatorics of the graphs this property of the graph, this property, namely each vertex can be the intersection of at most two maximal clicks. So these are the Quayle-Macaulay block graphs. For example, this is such an example. So in each vertex can intersect at most two maximal clicks of the graph. Usually, I mean, at least so far when people studied Quayle-Macaulay property of binomial edge ideals, they did it either imposing some conditions, extra conditions on the graph, as we did, for example, in this example, we consider, in this theorem, we consider considered block graphs, or they impose some extra conditions on the ideal itself, so that we can get some more information. In the same paper that I mentioned, we characterized say that this is so as a corollary of this theorem we get this one. So if we have actually a tree, a forest consists is a graph whose connected components are trees. So if I refer to a tree, the depth is n plus one, and we get that we get for a tree that the property of the binomial edge ideal of being Quayle-Macaulay is equivalent to the property to the complete intersection. And in the case of trees, this happens if and only if G is a path graph. So for trees, for example, we knew at that time which are Quayle-Macaulay. In the meantime, there are several other nice results. For example, this Italian paper, so to say, where they characterize the bipartite graphs whose binomial edge ideal is Quayle-Macaulay. It's a combinatorial condition which is not so easy to present. That's why I omitted it. But as I said, Tuesday, I have seen on archive a very nice paper which succeeded to characterize the Quayle-Macaulay property for chordal graphs and for graphs which contain a Hamiltonian path. Actually, I haven't read very carefully the whole paper, but I glanced over it and I noticed the following facts. So they found two combinatorial conditions. One of them implies Quayle-Macaulayness, the other one is implied by Quayle-Macaulayness. And in order to derive the chordal graph, for example, to characterize the chordal graphs whose binomial edge ideal is Quayle-Macaulay, they show that these two conditions, combinatorial conditions, they are equivalent. So that's why they succeeded to do this. They have also a nice conjecture there. But what I also find very interesting in this paper, so at least for these classes of graphs, the Quayle-Macaulay property does not depend on the field, although the graded Betti numbers depend on the field, and there is an example, a concrete example in that paper. So this was the first example of this kind which I have seen. So as I said before, sometimes in order to characterize the Quayle-Macaulay property, we impose conditions on the graph, or otherwise we impose we add some extra conditions on the binomial edge ideal itself. And such an attempt was in a recent paper of which I mentioned actually with Naoki and Giancarlo, where we studied Leachy ideals. So here in this slide, I briefly recall what Leachy ideals mean. So if we have a local regular ring, and we have two ideals, proper ideals in this ring. They are called directly linked if there exists a regular sequence Z such that we have these conditions fulfilled. And we say that I and J belong to the same linkage class if we have such a sequence of direct links between I and J. And if it happens that this J is even a complete intersection ideal, then we say that the other one is Lychy. And this Lychy ideals, I mean, ideals which are in the same linkage class, they share nice properties. For example, if I and J are linked, they are one of them is Cohen-Macaulay if and only if the other one is Cohen-Macaulay. So in particular, if we have in the same linkage class an ideal with a complete intersection, then the first ideal is Cohen-Macaulay. So any Lychy ideal is Cohen-Macaulay. And we characterized Lychy binomial Lychy ideals in this paper. So we showed that the binomial Lychy ideal is Lychy if and only if it is Cohen-Macaulay. This is not something new, but on the other hand, the regularity should be high, so it should be at least n minus 2. And the combinatorial characterization of the graph is the following. So G is either a path, in which case the binomial Lychy ideal is itself is a complete intersection, or it's a triangle where we are allowed to add, to connect in each or in some of its vertices some path. So the length of the path doesn't matter. We can add some paths in one vertex or in two vertices or in all three vertices. And also the length of the path, as I said, it doesn't matter. So all these kind of graphs have Lychy binomial edge ideals. Now I will, in the last part of the talk, I will concentrate on binomial edge ideals with quadratic Gromner basis. Now we know a lot of things about these ideals. In the original paper, in the first paper on binomial Lychy ideals, which I have mentioned already in the beginning, it was given this characterization for the graphs whose binomial Lychy ideals have quadratic Gromner basis. Actually, quadratic Gromner basis means that the generators form a Gromner basis with respect to the lexicographic order. And this condition says that if we have three vertices such that I is smaller than J is smaller than K, and we have this edge from I to K, then for any J in between, we should have both edges, IJ and JK. And these graphs were closed in this paper, were called closed graphs. But after a while, after a few years, we noticed that actually this kind of graphs which satisfy such a combinatorial condition are well studied in combinatorics. They are called proper interval graphs. And now we know we connected closed graphs to proper interval graphs, and we discovered some other combinatorial characterization for these graphs. But one of them, which we got in this paper in 2011, says that a graph is closed, or proper interval graph, as you like. So the graph is closed if and only if in the clique complex we can label the vertices of G such that the clique complex has the facets. So the maximal cliques in G are intervals. And we can order also these intervals such that the beginnings of each of these intervals should form an increasing sequence. So we can imagine the closed graph like a path of maximal cliques, so a complete graphs, and each two consecutive cliques may intersect in one vertex or two vertices or I don't know, as many as we like. There is also known in combinatorics another characterization of closed graphs. They are chordal, clove-free, so we are not allowed to have closed as induced subgraphs, and also we are not allowed to have one of these two graphs as induced subgraphs in our chordal graph. So this is a closed graph actually, and a proof, let's say, maybe not very simple, but which uses only Dirac's theorem for chordal graphs, we gave in this paper, which actually whose subject is actually binomial ideals of pairs of graphs. So now we know many things about closed graphs. Here there is an example. So we have a closed graph with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 maximal cliques. All the cliques are of dimension 2. For binomial edge ideals, for closed graphs, we gave a characterization of the Cohen-Macaulay property already in the paper in 2011. So we showed that this binomial edge ideal, which has a quadratic Gromner basis after all, is Cohen-Macaulay if and only if its initial ideal is Cohen-Macaulay. And there are two combinatorial characterizations of the graph. Most interesting is, most useful is this one, the last one, which shows that in the path of cliques, of maximal cliques, every two consecutive cliques are allowed to intersect in just one vertex. So, for example, the first example that we displayed of a closed graph, this does not have a Cohen-Macaulay binomial edge ideal because the cliques intersect in an edge, not in a vertex. So this is for sure not Cohen-Macaulay. While this example is an example of a graph which is closed, and its binomial edge ideal is Cohen-Macaulay because any two consecutive cliques in this graph intersect in just one vertex. So the first one and the second one in vertex 4, the second one, the third one in the vertex 6, and so on. So in order to have a Cohen-Macaulay binomial edge ideal for a closed graph, these cliques should form like a path in any, and such that any two consecutive cliques intersect in just one vertex. Now, when we know this notion of decomposable graph, we would say that that this graph has the binomial edge ideal Cohen-Macaulay because it consists of or can be decomposed in several components which are all complete graphs. So we may decompose this graph here or here or here in each intersection point. Now concerning the regularity for binomial edge ideals with quadratic Gromner basis, I'll mention this paper with Zarojanu, where we prove that if G is connected and closed, then the regularity of S mod JG and the regularity of S mod initial of JG, they coincide and they are equal to the length of the longest induced path in G. Now, the fact that this regularity are equal, it's not something very spectacular at this moment, because in the meantime, there is a paper by Konka and Varbaro on square-free Gromner degeneration, where they prove that if one has a graded ideal in a polynomial ring, then if this ideal has an initial ideal which is square free, then the extremal Betti numbers of the initial ideal and of the ideal itself, they coincide. In particular, they have the same regularity and same projective dimension. So, but what is really still interesting in this theorem is the fact that we could compute, give a precise formula for the regularity of S-mod JG. So in particular, in this case, for sure, the regularity does not depend on the characteristic of the field, but we don't know whether this is true in general or not. And we, to illustrate this theorem, we can look at this picture. So we can choose as the longest induced path either the red path or the blue path, and we see that the longest induced path in this graph has length 4, so the regularity is 4. And now I will come to the most recent paper of Naoki, Giancarlo, and me, where we studied powers of binomial edge ideals with quadratic Gromner basis. So this means the graph is closed. The graph for which we consider the binomial edge ideal is closed. And first, we computed the depths of the powers of JG in the case when JG is Cohen-Macaulay. If you remember, JG Cohen-Macaulay was the case when I have some maximal clicks, some complete graphs, and I join them such that every two consecutive clicks intersect in just one vertex. So this is the easiest case, so to say. So in this paper, we show that the depths of the powers of S mod JG and are equal to the depths of the powers of S mod modulo initial of JG. And this depth depends on the, not necessarily on the order for which we can we obtain a closed graph, but it depends on the size of the clicks which appear in the closed graph. So if we want to compute the depths of the second power, then we have to subtract here the largest size of the maximal clicks. Maybe this largest size does not appear in the first click of the closed graph. But anyway, what we can say from looking at this theorem is that we can get, okay, I will come back to this point. Now, let me say that our original question when we studied this, when we started this project, was whether we can find binomial edge ideals whose powers are Cohen-Macaulay. And then we noticed that we proved that if we have a closed graph with the property, then that at least one of its connected components is not a path, then for sure all the powers from the second power on is not Cohen-Macaulay. For the Cohen-Macaulay case, so when JG is Cohen-Macaulay, this proposition follows from this theorem, because we know the depths here, and we can see that the powers are not Cohen-Macaulay. If JG is not Cohen-Macaulay, then JG is not unmixed. So this implies that the symbolic powers of JG are not unmixed as well. But for closed graphs, we know that the symbolic powers and the ordinary powers coincide. So since the symbolic power is not unmixed, so it's not Cohen-Macaulay, this means that the ordinary power is not Cohen-Macaulay. So among the closed graphs, we cannot find binomial edge ideals whose powers are Cohen-Macaulay. And now coming back to our theorem, from here we also derive that the depth functions of JG and the initial of JG in the case that JG is Cohen-Macaulay are non-increasing. Actually, we expect the same behavior for any closed graph, not only for those which have a Cohen-Macaulay binomial edge ideal, but we couldn't prove this. This was one of the questions that we left in our paper. In the same paper, okay, we couldn't prove that for any closed graph. Also, we ask ourselves whether this equality between the depths of Vesmo JG of the powers of JG and the depths of the powers of initial of JG are also the same for any closed graph, and we don't have such an answer. But on the other hand, we could show that at least the depth limit of of JG coincide with the depth limit of initial of JG. And in order to show this equality and to give the explicit number here for this depth limit, of the depth, we show that actually the ideals JG and initial JG have the same analytic spread by using the Sagdi basis notion and also properties of the Lisa algebras of JG and initial of JG. And finally, we could prove that for closed graphs, so no matter whether the their binomial edge ideal is Cohen-Macaulay or not, so for any closed graph, we could compute the regularity of the powers, and again, we get equality between the regularity of the powers and the regularity of the powers of the initial ideal. And in the same article, since we have observed earlier that the ordinary and symbolic powers coincide for closed graphs, we ask ourselves whether we can extend this property for block graphs. But then we notice that we proved actually that this is not true. So for the block graph, the ordinary and symbolic powers coincide for any I, if and only if this happens in the second power, and if and only if G does not contain such an induced subgraph. So on the other hand, we notice for that this is called the net graph. So for this net graph, we notice that the second symbolic power is Cohen-Macaulay. The ordinary second power is not Cohen-Macaulay, because we have proved actually that if we have a block graph which is not a path, then the powers of JG are not Cohen-Macaulay. So one of the questions that we pose in this paper is whether we can classify all the block graphs with the property that the second symbolic power is Cohen-Macaulay. And also related to this proposition, we ask whether is it true that except the situation when G is a path, JG, all the powers of JG are not Cohen-Macaulay, but that this is not this is true for any connected or maybe any chordal graph only. What I mentioned before, whether it is true if the depth that the depth function of JG is non-increasing. I mean, we expect this for every closed graph. We could solve this problem only for graphs whose binomial edge ideal is Cohen-Macaulay, but we expect that this is true for every closed graph, especially because we easily derive that this property is fulfilled by the initial ideal of JG if G is closed. So the initial ideal is just an edge ideal in this case. Also, we asked the following question. So we have noticed that in some previous results for block graphs that we have these equivalences. Maybe this is true for any graph. For example, Giancarlo made a lot of experiments with the computer, and he said that for at most eight vertices, C and D are equivalent. And for the other implications, one could use the ideas in our paper. And finally, I would like to end my talk with a conjecture. Actually, we have noticed the following fact, which was really interesting, namely that for all the powers JG and initial of JG share the same graded Betti numbers. In the first case, when we consider JG and initial of JG, this conjecture exists already since 2011, because we have noticed in computer experiments that for a closed graph, JG and initial of JG share the same graded Betti numbers. And really, I worked a lot with closed graphs since then, and I haven't found any counter example. But we believe that this is true even for the powers. So as for the computer experiments, we did some of them, but of course we cannot calculate too high powers. I mean, we have noticed this property for second or the third power. In any way, the conjecture is true for sure when G is a complete graph. This is already folklore. And also when G is a path graph, because in this case, both ideals, JG and its initial ideal, are complete intersections, and which are generated in degree 2. And there is a paper of Guardo and Valtuil, which gives a positive answer to our conjecture for path graphs. But it might be that indeed, maybe one can hope that can prove this conjecture for closed graphs whose binomial edge ideal is Cohen-Macaulay. In our paper in 2011, we proved that for those closed graphs, indeed JG and initial of JG have the same graded Betti numbers. Maybe this is easier to prove in the general case, if our conjecture is true, of course. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Viviana. We will now take questions. You can open your mic, and also you can interact freely.
May I ask something?
Sure.
You know, there is I don't know exactly the conditions, but there is a very old paper by Valdi, you know, my colleague from Regensburg, and he proved long ago, maybe in the 70s, characterized those ideas for which all powers are Cohen-Macaulay. And these are exactly, on a very weak assumption, these are exactly the ideas which are shared by a regular sequence. You know, so this is very much related to what you said in your corollary. You know, I will not check the details of his assumptions. So he says, if says, maybe it's a prime idea. I don't know exactly the precise assumption that if all powers are Cohen-Macaulay, then the ideal must be generated by a regular sequence.
Yes, yeah. I mean, I understand what you say, but I don't know the paper. I should check it.
I give you later a link.
Proved in paper of Kaushik and Nori.
Kaushik and Nori also have such a result, right?
Right.
Yeah, so under very weak assumptions, I don't know exactly the assumption, but then if all powers are called Macaulay. The ring is called Macaulay. Maybe the prime idea defines the Cone Macaulay ideal or something like this. Yeah, yeah, sure. And then, no, you assume all powers are Cone Macaulay.
Right, then it is a complete.
It must be generated by a regular sequence, the ideal.
Right, this is important for this paper. On fibers of
brain. Yeah, I should check this.
Mm-hmm.
And do we know when the binomialized ideal is Gorenstein?
No, we don't know. Actually, this was also a problem which I wanted to approach with Naoki and Giancarlo, but we don't have a complete answer to this. For sure, we can say in the case of closed graphs, the binomial edge ideal is Gorenstein if and only if we have a path. I mean, if and only if it is a complete intersection. But otherwise, we don't know to characterize the Gorenstein property. So this is for closed graphs, it's easy. I mean, it's just an easy remark. But in the general case, we don't know.
Viviana, are there results about the condition being sequentially Cohn-Macaulay?
Actually, sequentially Cohn-Macaulay, I study right now with Giancarlo and
okay. We don't tell us what you find.
No, we just started. I mean, we don't have such great results, but Actually, for a while I believe that closed graphs have sequentially Cohn-Macaulay binomial edge ideals. Any closed graph, but it seems this is not true. Oh. Even for closed graphs, you have to impose some extra conditions on the graph. But we don't have yet any spectacular result in this direction. I let you know if we get something.
Okay.
So Sara, maybe you should also know tell us what you are working right now, so that we don't intersect with the other groups of researchers in India or in Japan, or I don't know.
Well, we just finished some projects and we also tried a little bit the powers, but not really seriously. Since we just finished some projects, we haven't entered a new one seriously yet. So everybody can feel free to think about anything. Right now, no overlap. I think at the moment, at least.
Do you have the net free condition that you have given, that you have mentioned?
Yeah.
Is that the cycles do like? What about cycles? Are they net free? I can't recollect what it was. I kind of missed. Are they net free?
The cycles.
Cycles, yes.
Well, I think they are net free because net free is a triangle, and in each, triangle, and in each vertex.
Okay. Oh, that's almost complete intersection. That net that you're talking about. I think we have proved, we have mentioned that in our paper. That it's an almost complete intersection.
Yeah, it might be.
Okay. So I was wondering whether, I have done some experiments, and I think for cycles, the symbolic and the original powers coincide. Is something that I.
I also discussed a little bit with Arvin this question. I also believed a while ago, but I couldn't prove this. Indeed, the ordinary and symbolic powers, they coincide. And I know that Arvin told me that he also thought about this problem.
So that if your conjecture is proved, this will be included in that. That's good to know.
You have an example of a graph for which for the power, the depth of the ideal and depth of the initial, they're different.
I mean, if the graph is not closed, I think
you can. You think or you know?
Right now, I don't know because I don't remember exactly. But for sure, I think, for example, for the claw, if you compute for the powers, you don't get the same depth, I believe. But I would try to compute such an example and send it to you if you like.
Yeah, this would be nice. Thank you.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
So there is this notion of permanental ideal, right? And instead of taking the determinant, you take the permanent, right? So it's something, it's like it's have the same sum, but you don't for all those products taken off some of after all the permutations, but you don't have the plus minus one sum. Anyway, so do you consider such an extension for this theory of edge idea?
I haven't considered such extension, but you can ask directly Arvind. I think he knows something about this.
Mm-hmm. Okay. About permanent edge ideal, I think Professor Herzog has written a paper.
But long ago, I know nothing what is inside.
After that, I have studied this almost complete intersection property of this permanent. I mean, in two gross and matrix only.
Yeah, but not so much is known about permanent.
Yeah, not so much. Yeah.
Maybe the theory is also not as nice as for binomial edge ideas, I would expect.
Right. Okay. Jorgen, we considered it in our paper where we studied these orthogonal embeddings with Antonello and Volkmar.
Mm-hmm. You know better, sir. What is in the paper?
No, we considered these ideals, permanental edge ideals, just for some purposes. At some point, we named such ideals permanental edge ideals, but we just looked at them very shortly because of our aims in those ideals. But if you remember in that paper, a characteristic of the field was very important. So as you say, the behavior there is not as nice as binomial edge ideals.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true.
Professor Hebe had raised his hand a few minutes ago. I guess he wanted to say something. Professor Hebe, is he around?
No. I want to also ask Viviana. Yeah, he has some research on Gorenstein binomial edge IDR. But someone, asked.
Yeah,
Gorenstein. Yeah, Gorenstein binomial edge IDR is also quite interesting.
What do you know about the linear strand of the resolution? Did we have a paper, Sarah, about linear strand? I think so, right?
Yes.
Yes.
You wrote yes. That paper. Okay, I haven't mentioned it in
my but we know
presentation.
We know about the length of the linear strand, right, for example?
Yes, and we know, we describe all the Betti numbers in the linear.
Yes. Linear strand. Hello?
Yeah, we lost contact with her.
With Sarah, yeah. And of course, I find also interesting to find the formula for the index, you know, how long you have a linearity in the resolution. If there's a way to compute the index for binomial edge ideal.
I think I'm not so sure about that, but I think that Sarah proved in quite an old paper in 2013 or something like that, that for binomial edge ideals, we have, a binomial edge ideal is linearly related if and only if it has a linear resolution. Is it right, Sarah?
Yes.
I think you proved this in a very old paper. So
yes.
For any graph.
Yes, for any graph. Yes.
A linear related linear resolution is the same.
Yes.
So you have only the two extreme cases. I mean,
exactly.
Really? I didn't.
And even for since I was disconnected for a few seconds, I just complete the sentence that for linear strand, we even if you remember, Jürgen considered the determinantal facet ideals, not only for binomial edge ideals.
For much general, in higher dimensional situations, so to say, and,
yes.
And
we introduced the generalization of
the median numbers of the linear strand, right, in terms of some combinatorics of this. That's right. What about that all powers have linear resolution? What is this situation? We have such a situation
only in the case of the complete graph.
This is this is follows from your theorem.
That all the powers have a linear resolution.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't, I mean, this is folklore. If you have
one direction graph, what?
But if you impose that all the powers have a linear resolution, in particular, the ideal has to have a linear resolution.
So it's equivalent. That's right. So not so interesting. So what is still interesting?
I think there are still some questions. I mean, also in our paper we pose some questions. There are some questions also in this very recent paper of the Italian group. Very interesting question. So I really think something very spectacular. Okay, I haven't read very careful. The paper is very recent, but as I said, they found a combinatorial condition which implies Cohen-Macaulay, and then another combinatorial condition which is implied by Cohen-Macaulay. And for chordal graph, for example, they show that these two combinatorial conditions, they are equivalent. And they have also some other interesting questions there.
So they have, if and only if conditioned for chordal graphs to be Cohen-Macaulay.
Yeah, but maybe, I mean, they have also conjecture saying that they believe that condition which is implied by Cohen-Macaulayness actually acts also in the other way around. So maybe they can get a full characterization of Cohen-Macaulay binomial edge ideals, which would be really actually one of the authors in the audience.
I explain. We believed actually that the second condition, the one that is implied by Cohen-Macaulay, is equivalent. But it is also possible that all three conditions are equivalent for all binomial edge ideals. We don't have a counterexample also for the other. But the second one is, I think, good from my point of view, because you can read from the calcet. So it's the one that we found for bipartite graphs that it was written also in the slide.
So you know it for bipartite graphs?
Yes, also for bipartite, for chordal, and for a graph that contains an Hamiltonian path. These three classes also the all three conditions are equivalent.
And you believe in the best case this would be always true for any graph?
Yes.
In the best case. But this is already nice families where you have the equality, where you have this property.
Okay, are there any other questions? Well, perhaps not. So we had a very interesting session. Thanks to a nice talk by Viviana.
Thank you very much, Professor Verma.
Thank you for coming online, and let's hope that we will meet sometime very soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.